Всем еще раз привет, ну что ж, вторая карта, интересный выбор персонажа у нас, появление поэта, появление Лекана, вообще не интересно, да, как вообще взяли Mousesports.
They say you learn the most from losing, Cinderin, and if that's the case, seems like Mouse are going to go back into game number two, trying to kind of still make this mid-game push lineup work for them. Cinderin, you have a lot of experience losing, of course. That's why you're the absolute best Dota analyst in the world. So you give me your take. Did they fix the mid-game push problems with this Lycan?
They learned a lot from game number one. They gave the Mag Jugger again. Let's see if they learned anything from that. Okay, so yes, it is a very different approach this time around for Mouse. IG, I would say, very similar lineup in essence. They've obviously swapped out a couple of pieces, but the idea of the lineup is fairly similar. This time, instead of the Crystal Maiden, they have the Ogre Magi. I love this pick. I'm personally really biased for that hero. I love Ogre in general, but in this game, to me, it was an absolutely amazing pick. Really hard for Ricky to deal with early on. Can't really bring him at all. They have two great heroes to give Bloodlust to in Juggernaut and Lina, and arguably even the Magnus can actually use it very well.
Right.
And they just want to secure their lanes and get off to a good start, and then eventually we're going to reach the same type of game where Mousesports just don't have team fight. Like, they actually don't have any team fight. Their only stun is Fiend's Grip, and their entire damage is single target, apart from Ricky Ultimate. So I'm worried. I actually feel like this draft from Mouse is, relative to IG's, is worse than in game number one. I'm not feeling this adaptation. I hope they prove me wrong.
Well, we'll see what Mouse can provide in the first 20 minutes of the game. I mean, we also said that, like, in game one, they didn't really take advantage so much of their Aegis timing as they really should have. They also have potentially, maybe they scale a little bit better than they did last time.
Woo! Bounty rune!
Bounty rune stolen, baby! The crowd goes wild! But this time around, Alina, right? Instead of an SF, last time around, we were looking at a Juggernaut SF with a Magnus, and it was like very clear, much better late game. This time around, we have a Lycan, Templar Assassin, plus an Abaddon. It does seem like they'll be able to go late game a little bit better against IG. Do you think IG still have the advantage now?
If this goes really late, I think the item to look out for me is Abaddon getting an Aghanim Scepter. I think you want to have at least the counterplay so that if an RP comes out, you can
actually mid lane drop it real fast. He's going to end up going down. All the armor in the world, apparently, for the Ogre Magi. It's not enough for him to be able to survive through a three-man. He underestimated Sin, the power of Howl.
Howl did so much there. Three heroes with that extra 10 damage early on makes a very big difference. It's like you're three and a half heroes there, essentially, instead of just three. And that is too much for Ogre to handle. So very nice from Mousesports to secure this first blood. Off to a good start like last game. Getting a little bit of pressure on this time around the mid lane. Yeah, we're going to see how it works out. In my opinion, IG have been at their weakest when Bobuka has been on free end. I think that's the worst hero of the tournament so far that I've seen him play. So that could give Mousesports some hope as far as that goes. It's a lot harder for him to pressure mid, especially with this free end. Can't really get in there. So they know this mid matchup can be really, really great for the TA.
Because it's not really a true roaming hero, right?
No.
It's more of a static babysitter that just kind of ruins lanes for people.
Yes, and of course it still has the whole warding aspect, which is great, that you can get into the enemy jungle and plant wards. That's still in play, but Bobuka, I think, is really good at finding openings and finding kills early, and in my opinion, the way these lanes are being played, it's going to be difficult for him to do so in this game.
Early sleep there from Spartan. That is going to play havoc on his mana cost. But unfortunately, not much with the that one. Fortunately, he's got clarity on the combo.
Do you think that spell should still cost 165 mana?
I do not think so.
I feel like it's absurdly expensive.
That is half his mana pool. That's pretty insane.
Pretty much, yeah.
Maybe next time, you're going to take it? Oh, doesn't look like maybe either one of them got that. It's like maybe the creep's got it. Maybe next time. He's going to be caught here. They have the spin. They lay down the sentry. He's going to jump over to Bobuka. But Bobuka's there to lay hands on him. It's Q with the burning ignite that will actually take the even kill.
So if you're Mousesports in this game, I think what you need to look at is, oh, actually, you need to look at mid.
Yeah. Yeah, this may actually have enough burst damage here because OP is not going to be able to lay out the sun to stop this damage. Thug, hit by the ignite, doesn't really care too much. Looks like he should have refraction coming up soon, so Q is forced to back up. It's looking like laning phase is going to go well for Mouse once again. They've already kind of won the mid lane. We have the top lane where no matter what, Skylark should be able to get some decent farm out of this. And then a Lycan facing up against a Magnus, it'll be like kind of like a farm war like before, right?
Yeah, pretty much. This bottom lane, I think, favors Mag more than in the last game where he eventually lost out to Timber.
Yeah.
I don't know if this lane ever reaches a point where Lycan is going to really threaten him. Sure, when you're level 6, you can try to go for the shapeshift play, but still, Magnus can obscure TP. It's a big cooldown use. It's probably going to be relatively quiet down there. I'm a bit surprised, actually, that these mid kills are happening the way they are. The first one, understandably so, there's like 3 heroes and they're not ready for it, but OP needs to be careful not to give too big of an advantage to TA. This is already not a good matchup for Lina. Not particularly good anyway compared to most matchups. I would like to see Q just camp here. The rotation to kill Ricky was nice, but at the same time, if it comes at the cost of giving up plays in mid where OP gets solo killed, or actually, well, there was a gank, but if your core dies mid, to rotate a support top to kill a Ricky, the play itself is not worth it. Maybe it was OP's mistake to play safer, you know? Needs to just concede a couple CS for that play, but...
I mean, you would say the play style's got to be a little different, right, for Lina compared to the SF last game. They played very passive last game. This time around, they do kind of need our Lina to get off to a decent start. Otherwise, he doesn't hit that, like, 15-minute window where he starts killing people.
Yeah, Lina is slightly worse when it comes to recovery. Of course, you still have great wave clear with Dragon Slave Lightstriker Raid, but it's not Shadow Raid.
Right.
You can't farm stacks as easily. You can't retreat to the jungle in as effective a manner. Oh, mid lane again. Ogre just left.
Starts running back, but it's going to be too late. The LSA is dodged. Thug. Oh, they need the right click, but they're not going to. Oh, they get it. Both of them swing. It's going to be Thug who connects first. 3-1 now, 5 minutes in. Once again, Mousesports taking the early lead in the laning phase.
This lane war that Mouse has in mid is giving a lot of information. They just saw the Ogre rotate away. They get just a short moment of opportunity and they go on it right away and get a big kill here again on the lead. And this is what I was saying. I feel like the Ogre actually just needs to... If Bane is camping mid, Ogre can camp mid. It offsets, and IG are all right with that.
Like, yeah.
Both Ogre and Bane are heroes who... When you get to the mid game, they have more of a limited impact in teamfights. It's hard often for Bane to get grips off. Of course, he has the potential compared to Ogre, who's, you know, Ogre is bloodless and
pretty much
a bloodless machine with a little bit of a stun. And that's why if these two offset and they're both stuck in mid, I feel like it favors the Ogre team because Bane needs the levels more and Bane needs the advantage more. Ogre is okay with being low level and not having too much happen as long as his cores are farming.
And again, it's we talked about it from game number one, similar strategy in game number two. Mouse need to win the lane because they need to go into that 15 to 25 minutes and be very dominant, take a lot of objectives, pick up the agents, and start threatening for high ground. Yeah. You know, all these things are off of a strong static laning phase for them. And it seems like the kills in mid are currently what's getting them the big advantage.
Safe lane is favoring Madara way more than I thought it would. He is far ahead of the mag. He's almost doubling cover now, 44 CS to max 25. He will come down here and get a big wave, however, so he can offset it a little bit. But Madara is doing a great job here, and Mouse arguably off to a better start than in game number one, even though it's maybe one or two less kills. It's just the lanes are going better overall. Skylark is having a good time on a bad end. Both of their other two cores are farming excellently, building up a big advantage in their lanes respectively.
Nice pick up there from maybe next time, grabbing that hard creep away from Bulbapin. Maybe it's in Madara's nature, you know. Oh, mid with the haste rune. They're actually going to try and go into Q. They sleep up the Lina, actually putting the Nightmare on himself. Q hoping to be able to get Thug off of him, and it does work like a charm. Thug is forced back away. Maybe it's just Madara's nature, right? He's a little bit more comfortable playing the CS war, and not like Timbersaw outright clicks a mag early, but I like it. Maybe next time. Nice jump over the trees here. Lays out the smoke preemptively to try and slow down burning before he finishes him off, but he's not able to get away before the dust can wear out. 3-2 now.
I like the idea from Mousesports of having a bad end retreat a little bit to the jungle and just giving Ricky the top lane, but realistically there's not that many plays Ricky can make. He can try mid. Mid was already going great though. Doesn't really need to be bottom. So he just needs to make sure that he gets a game, gets some good levels up. And Abaddon is really fast at jungling, especially with this. He went for a Talon build, and now he also has phase. It is an option they have just to pull jungle him for a little bit, give Riki level 6. But it still gives information. If your Riki is laning top, you know a lot as IG. Right now he's actually stalking the Lina here in the Dire jungle. And of course if he's laning, he also can't work for him. So it's a bit of a trade-off about what you think is most important in the moment.
Speaking of our Baron, we see a lot of hand of my distance in this major so far. Most of them have actually been picked up by the offlaners for various reasons. Do you think this is a hand of minus game for Skylark? Do you think you should focus on the Vlad Silvercrest and just try and get as much mid-game output for the team as possible?
Let's see if he survives first, right?
Yeah, he's nice good.
Play. So, what we've seen in this tournament so far is that Baron, I think, has gone for Midas in multiple games, but I think Kezu has played it 2 or 3 times with Team Secret, and he bought Vlad's Crest in both games, or maybe 3 games if there were 3. I think that was filled every time. I like that for Secret because they have like a really good timing push that they were looking to do, or have like really good mid-game team fight, and Midas might delay that. Looking at Mouse's lineup, I feel like it's similar. That in this game you don't want to go Midas. You already have 2 cores that are farming great in the side in side lane and mid respectively. And you want to hit that peak around 20 to 25. So if he has really high value items at that point in time, and you can expect to get rogue probably as well with your lineup.
Oh, IG, they stick around perhaps a bit too long, trying to get aggressive in this bottom lane, and now they have the Lycan coming out of the jungle. Oh, Skewer not quite working out there. Hope not to be able to pick up Madara, is going to be forced to use the early RP to stall up the Lycan, but it looks like Lycan might still be able to run him down. Finally wears the loose on the ultimate, and Spartan doesn't have any mana to be able to use a brain sap, so it looks like they're not going to be able to catch him out. Instead, they just get Q's Ogre for that ultimate. OP is pressuring
no TP on him.
He's caught by a Templar Assassin. Trap is going to be blocked up by Maybe Next Time until the next TA trap is ready to go. Beautiful plays by Maybe Next Time. That second TA trap was barely even needed because the body blocks were so on point.
Very, very nice from him. And Mouse, they further their advantage. This early game, I think, is going very, very well for them overall. It's on the graph, it's not big amounts we're talking here, but it's just the feel in the game of how much they're actually gaining in terms of just momentum and being us kind of knowing that they will get this Roche. Yeah. I think in this game you can call it almost a disaster if they don't get Roche with the lineup that they have. It takes a very short amount of time and you need to push out the lane to go there more or less. This is looking good for them. The question is, when and how do they start pushing the towers? Because it's one thing to gain an advantage, but you have to be able to take those objectives. In the last game, they were doing a better job at that than they are right now. They had already taken, I think, both side towers at this point, or at least were close. This time it's kind of favoring the other way, actually. IG did a good amount of damage on him.
Yeah, IG and mid. This is very interesting. I think this is adaptation, especially with having a Lina mid, is that they're rotating burning into mid lane very early on, where we were kind of suggesting, you know, we should do it earlier. And in this game, too, already trying to take that mid tower, using that healing ward to great effect. They're not facing up against a Dream Protector this time around, too, so all this damage is permanent, even if they are forced away, but that's not going to be the case. Mounts are going to be overrun. No real defense for them here. They're just going to try and take 2 different side lane towers at the same time. You can see Skylark pressuring the top tower while the Lycan takes bottom.
Butcher got a very good aggressive ward out down here as well. Likely to yield some sort of important information later on. TA likes to farm in this area. There's a chance that Lycan will retreat in there. And something we actually haven't talked about in this game is as far as Lycan goes. I think a very important aspect of the hero is scouting with wolves. They do have a Riki, of course, so there might be true set out already for IG, but it just gives them an opportunity to have this very low risk scouting, so Riki doesn't necessarily have to do it.
What I liked about Secret is that, you know, I want to reference them because it does seem like Mouse are trying to replicate some of that style, a much faster style, no hand of Midas's, you know, fast pushes. They do this quite a bit.
Rotation on top.
They're going to be able to get the Fiend's Grip onto Burning with the spin going on, so this should be a pretty easy kill, especially with Maybe Next Time able to slow him down. Bulbico actually threatening the ultimate there. Maybe they silence him, they can stop it, unable to get off that one in time, and now it's going to be Maybe Next Time potentially blown up by OP, but OP in trouble. RP just in time from XXS. Spartan running forward, hoping to be able to catch that Lina, just can't quite get him. Madara gets healed up a little bit, Aphonic Shield doing some work. Is he going to be able to walk away? The Shockwave, not enough. It gets the wand just in time. Skylark keeps his carry alive for the time being. XXS blinks forward, but now Baby Street a little bit too far. Robic is there to be able to help him out. Skewer backwards, but Thug's able to finish him off. They look for more. Q's going to be up next, slowing him down. Bobica is sitting on the side here. He's looking at Madara, who's very low. Does have that armlet toggle. Skylark also doesn't have much mana to work off of. Maybe he can finish him off, but he doesn't want to commit and end up losing his own life.
I get out. Nice armlet toggle here from Madara, and of course, they also could play around the Howl here at nighttime. End up getting a good fight there. That looked like it was going to go better for IG than it did, but Maus salvaged it nicely, keeping the Lycan alive there. Very, very important.
And that's the kind of exact kind of rotation that we're referring to, right? That moving, you know, early smoke up, your safe lane core, moving into the tier two, TPing out, and just like a very fast rotation that catches the enemy team off guard.
Yep. These quick moves from Maus are working out right now. They need to keep it up, though. TA already with a 13-minute Deso. Roche should be easy pickings. I actually think they could go for it right now. They know RP is on cooldown. Even if there's vision in the area, they have the Wolves and Ricky to play off of. They can secure that area. It looks like it might actually be the intention here. They're bringing in the Lycan, Bane here as well. And they are going to go for the Roche. Yeah. TP comes in from Baden as well. Very important in the last fight as well, by the way. Skylark came in for a very timely aquatic shield on Madara when he was about to die.
This is dangerous. IG are actually going to try and fight this one out. Without the RP, he blinks forward, skewers backwards. They've already blown up, almost blown up Spartan. He gets a little bit of spin, managed to silence himself. Meanwhile, XXS is the target from Madara. He's going to be able to pick up that one along with Bobica. And IG, they've stumbled into a world of hurt as they try and contest the Roshan. Last time around, they just gave it up to Mousesports, but the timing was best. This time, they try and contest, and it goes oh so horribly for them.
Death's
great fight from Maus, and at the same time, also uncharacteristic from IG. I think that fight is impossible without RP, and that's why Maus went for the Roche in the first place. You have to expect, as IG moving in, that you are going to get scouted by either Ricky or the Wolves, so you won't really have the element of surprise, and Maus are like, oh, great, you want to fight us? Well, I'm going to take a 5-0 fight and the Roche, and this is essentially just IG feeding them a bigger advantage. This was not necessary for them to do. They could have played a bit safer, giving the Roche away. But Maus are building a really, really big advantage. This is what they were probably hoping for in game number one. 6,000 gold, minute 14. A lot of experience as well, 7,500 on that one. And it's a very, very big lead here. And when you have these big leads, it kind of compensates for if your draft, for example, doesn't have too much lockdown or...
Right.
Because you can itemize. You can just itemize what you're lacking. If you're rich enough, in theory, any lineup can work.
Yeah,
as long as you have money, you can just buy what you're missing.
Yeah, get a Basher Abyssal for the Lycan, for example. You know, you get a little bit of lockdown from him. Or maybe the TA is just so big that he two-shots people. And exactly. Who needs lockdown? The targets are dead.
Pretty much.
A Mask of Madness picked up for Madara. We've seen this a couple times from these Lycans. After all, as they use that ultimate, it's not like they need to use many spells, so...
Yep.
And it's not like we're fearing a whole lot of physical damage, right? Because now the Mask of Madness is strictly a minus armor business rather than amplify damage, and it's not too much coming out from IG just yet.
It might seem a bit counterintuitive for people to get this item on Lycan since you already have maximum speed of skill shift, more than max. Oh, maybe next time? Will probably die here.
Yeah, CL is a
correct prediction. He did indeed.
Good job. This is why you're the best analyst in the world.
Saw that coming from a mile away. All right, so anyway, Madara with the Mask of Madness doesn't give any move speed benefits when you are in your ultimate form, but the thing is, since you have so fast move speed, it's just about being able to hit people. And the attack speed plays a really big role even in your ulti, and when you're out of your ulti, it increases your farming rate. It's that simple. You just farm a lot faster, push towers faster, and with the armlet build-up, your hero hits really, really hard. I love this build. I think it's super good. I think you had to rethink Lycan since the Necrobook build just seemed to not have the same impact anymore.
Right.
And we've seen both MP and now Madara have great success with this build so far.
Burning?
Yep.
Spin TP out. Not really feeling comfortable with pushing too far.
Oh, Bobica! He could overgrowth TP. He doesn't even overgrowth. Oh, why would he, actually? No need.
Mouths are going to go for that tier 2 mid, and there should be nothing that stops them at this point. I mean, they've got Vlad, almost a solo crest, I believe, for Skylark. They've got an Aegis, Blink, Deso. This is one of those moments, kind of similar to the Roshan, where it's like, IG should absolutely stay away from Maus at all costs.
Yeah, this time they have the RP, but I would say it's, in a way, just offset by TA. Something we actually didn't talk about, I don't know if the panel touched upon it, how good Abaddon is against Magnus.
Yeah, yeah.
Having this borrow time where if you get RP'd or if one of your cores get RP'd, you can just manually trigger borrow time and immediately go into a aquatic shield and keep your core alive. That means when it comes to fights and pushes, Thug feels confident standing next to the tower. He can get saved by the Abaddon, And even if he gets RP'd and they get the aquatic shield out before the skewer, he can straight blink because he had refraction and didn't even take damage from the RP. It's proving to be tricky for IG to play this game. They don't even have an assist on Magnus yet. Very, very unusual for XXS to not have had any impact in that regard 18 minutes in. And they just have to dodge fights. It's not happening. They're going to fight. Not fight. Farm, rather. Take bottom tower.
Yeah, they're going for those later game hand Midases.
This could be a high ground for it.
Yeah, absolutely. There's no reason for Mouse to back down at this point. At the very least, forced IG back to the base and away from that bottom lane push. That's what's happening. You can already see Burning and Q stall up. Q's going to start TPing back. Burning may have to follow suit here. He's hoping Mouse will back away, and he's going to continue trying to farm here. But you can see Thug is not backing down. He's got the aphotic shield. He's getting some damage onto the tier 3. Oh, Laguna Blade kind of scares him away.
Now he's backing down.
Yeah.
Wonder why.
He's still got the Aegis.
Might as well give him the Aegis. You don't need it.
All right, so TPs are going to be forced back. Burning took a gamble in some ways. He didn't TP out. He maintained a position where he could continue to farm. And once they leave top, he's actually going to be able to take all that farm at the top half.
And this can still get tricky for Mousesports. I feel like by no means are they in the clear and just kind of have won this game. They have a good lead. The graphs, however, are not... They don't keep going in their favor. It's kind of plateaued for now. At this 8k mark, and the problem is all this pushing doesn't yield anything unless they take the tower. This time they are against the Treant, and it's just so strong to have this ability in the game where you know that as long as you hold, that's also why Lina can throw out this Laguna. If you just scare Mouse off, they wasted their time, and you're out farming them because Burning wasn't even there.
So which is why we look at that second Aegis timing. Right, like the second Aegis, it should be where Mouse are exceptionally strong, and they have, like, while they may not be able to chip away at the tier 3 because they are against a Treant Protector, they have much better insurance when they do go high ground, right, because of the abandon, right? They're less scared of the Magnus. They can make like a two-man push forward into that, and if you get an RP, who cares? Borrow time on one, Aphotic Shield on the other, and its whole entire thing is kind of reset.
The main thing is that the Aphotic Shield has to come out so TA can blink. If TA doesn't blink out and gets RP, gets skewered, it can actually get pretty tricky. And Abaddon, if it comes down to it, thinking about it twice, I don't actually know if it's possible. If Mag RPs into instant skewer, I think it's faster than Abaddon casting ult and casting Aphotic Shield. So more than likely, you need to skewer the TA far enough away that he's out of range of the Aphotic Shield cast afterwards. If you manage to do that, that's what's so hard about playing high ground against Magnus. If he gets any jump and skewers into base, you're so far out of position that you can just die twice. Even if you're 10k net worth ahead, your carry is just in an awful position in the enemy base. Now, however, we're going to have a BKB come out for the TA as well, and that gives him a lot of safety. It's an extremely high-value item right now because when it comes to right-clicks, only really Burning and OP will be able to put those out through it. But the damage is not significant enough from this Lina at all yet. So you should feel pretty safe in that with Refraction on.
Mouse controlling for now. We have Roshan coming up in 2 minutes. They're positioning themselves to see if they can actually catch Burning here. Burning is going to TP towards the tail end of his spin out and almost gets caught in the process.
If Spartan had 4-staff ready, Burning was dead. And I think he had no idea about this. I'm curious about this 4-staff pickup. This is very unusual to see on Bane. Can, of course, be helpful against, once again, the Magnus if you have a good clutch 4-staff play or you can force people in overgrowth and try to get some distance. But it's an uncharacteristic item pick up here from Spartan. Well, they're going to try high ground again. I don't know about this one, to be honest.
If you lose this fight, you might end up losing Roshan, right?
Yeah, I feel like this is not the time to go, and they don't want to. They just pushed in the wave, they forced IG back, and now they're going to chill and farm the jungle. So I like this, actually. They put some fear into IG's heart here and made them go back. And then they're just farming them. So knowing that Burning is top is really valuable information for Mouse. Could even set themselves up a kill here. They don't have any additional information, so they might feel like he's not alone. Actually, Burning plays it safe. Taking the mantle instead.
There's a decent amount for Burning to be scared of. They have one support that is able to provide a disable through the spin. And then you've got another support in the Riki who can actually silence you before you even spin. So he's always got to be pretty paranoid.
Moment here if IG catch them. They have a great ward placement that they were smoking down to, but didn't dare to go in. Could they have caught Thug there? That would have been a huge kill with Rodion being alive. And Thug would have probably had... he would have had 5x. Still a really big pickoff.
I like
not happening.
They- kind of set up like two-man teams there. They've got two sitting on the light game. They've got Skylark, who's really all that's needed to be able to protect a core, sitting on Thug. And as a result, IG don't really have too many openings.
I feel like this is free Roche. I don't think there's many people going for this. They learned their lesson last time without a rule.
Jesus.
Good lord.
Roshan doesn't stand a chance, and I have to wonder how much of a chance a tier 3 tower is going to stand against a Mousesports push.
As crazy as it might sound, it's so hard. It's
because of the armor change.
It's not just mag. You also have to be worried about getting Overgrowth. Overgrowth can also sit up this warrior. Your Nautix is one off, the other one's available.
Nice aggressive force staff. Ooh, that's a cool play. Managed to get the Nightmare following that up. OP being set up on. They're going to try and finish him off with the Fiend's Grip. Easy kill for Thug. He pops a DKB nice and early, ensuring a 1-2 punch. They managed to get a third kill onto Bobica, and Entangle's not going to be enough. Now Moderate's going to be freed from the roots. Immediately starts focusing on that tier 3. Now the backdoor protection is up for the time being. They also pop the cliff. The creeps are closing in very rapidly, though. Madara is going to run out of his ultimate here pretty soon, but it may be enough for them to be able to take this tier 3. Oh, flick forward. Nice! Beautiful smoke cloud there for maybe next time. Stop with the skewer. He still manages to get it back with the RP following up, but a beautiful defensive Nightmare. Actually protects Thug a little bit, but it looks like they aren't going to be able to finish him off. Fraction goes off. A little bit in more HP. Has an aquatic shield. A little bit more heal. Thug is actually barely surviving through all this until he finally loses that Aegis. Now the question is, can IG kill him a second time? LSA timed out, but they managed to get the Omni Slash onto Thug. He's protected a little bit by that aquatic shield. Managed to finish on Q again on a sliver of HP. Both Refraction and Aphonic Shield, not going to be enough. IG pounce. They see the opportunity. They've taken out a core. They get an extra support and are going to be able to find the advantage. Well, big pickups on both sides, but they lost their tier 3 tower.
Yeah, they helped the barracks. You have to wonder for Mousesports at this point if the right choice was to go back and go for the shrines. But at the same time, RP is used. You're feeling pretty confident. You also know that Overgrowth is on cooldown. I believe both those ultimates down, but they still played very nicely around the Lina stun. And all I can say is great play from Spartan to set it all up. The first aggressive force staff actually allowed them entry into a base fight that should have been super hard to set up in the first place. Not only did they get the Lina, but the IG team had this Help a Friend syndrome where they can't save this Lina. Can't really actually save, so Ogre dies, then Treant dies. And in spite of all of that going against IG, they still defended. Really impressive, in my opinion, that they don't lose barracks there. And now that Roshan is dead for a long time, IG might get the time to come back into this game.
One of the big
still
things
was a big climb for Mouse.
That's going to be really difficult for IG that we haven't touched on just yet is OP. Playing the Lina, right, a little bit more of an early game hero, but he hit level 15. And he took that microphone respawn timer with the Bloodstone. We're going to be talking about two lives of Lina in every single one of these fights. So even when you think you have the Aegis, you have the numbers advantage, right? 6 versus 5, no problem. OP actually kind of counteracts that, especially
you
being right there at the end.
Is that normal?
I feel like in some ways you
say
do
no,
need
Cap.
Some additional
it's
push
normal.
Out.
Say no.
I'm not saying it's normal, but I kind of feel like it's needed. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm wondering what the logic is here. I think Mouse is a separate damage source. He gets 2 ticks off refraction when he attacks, so that's nice.
Faster side lane pushes.
Absolutely,
well.
The wave clear is great. I'm not saying it's a bad choice. It's just very unusual, I think, at this point for Linas to get this item. Often you would see them get something like either the Yules or the Shadow Blade are the normal go-tos.
Yeah.
But this is different. And what they might be thinking here, IG, is that they just need more damage. They need to be able to get through, first of all, break the refraction, but they also need to be able to kill the heroes. They have the control with Mag and the Treant. They have to guarantee that they can kill off the heroes during it. I don't even know if Mjolnir is that amazing in this game in particular that would justify the build-up for that in addition. But,
well, if he gets to level 20, we could have a little bit of sniper syndrome. Him sitting way off in the back and having an instant kill shot, it's going to be hard to
Absolutely.
Deal with.
Here comes the smoke. It would be a pretty upset, I guess, but they were really like huddling together. Maybe that was just a bonding moment. We're still in it, guys. This is where our tower once stood.
Yep. Sit together, sing Kumbaya.
Yeah. IG strikes me as the kind of team that would do that. Not the Mousesports team that's literally clapping and slamming their hands into the table pregame.
Yeah. I mean, then one side we've got Kumbaya for IG, and Mousesports, you've got like Spartan like, you know, chants going on.
It's cool to see themselves, them pumping themselves up.
I mean, I was going to say, like, it seems like Spartan picked Vayne for a very specific reason, right? Using Vayne's grip, and then he can go ahead and have both his hands off the keyboard mouse and slam on the table and stuff and cheer on his team.
That's also why you pick Enigma. You cast Black Hole and you just stand up.
Yes!
But actually, on a serious note, though, I think a big part of the reason they did pick the Vayne was it can match up against Ogre early. We're obviously right. past that stage now, but it was important for Mousesports to be able to offset the Ogre early on. It's been a classic counter pick for a while, especially back when Ogre was very popular. It was picked in multiple games.
The laning phase is so important
it
right,
is.
For Mousesports. To
when you have this kind of lineup, you really just can't afford to lose your laning fight. At least not a large margin. So we have the Diffusal Blade on Ricky. I don't know how much we've talked about that. Yields some interesting benefits to the hero. Obviously great damage output.
Yeah, we
saw
it.
Mana burn.
Saw it on Molina earlier here. He was deep being out.
Yep.
It was pretty impressive, the amount of damage that maybe next time is outputting.
The mana burn is actually pretty nice against a hero like Ogre. He's got a really low mana pool in fights, so it could prevent him from casting that extra Fire Blast or Bloodlust that you need to recast during fights. But yeah, standard Ricky build. We've seen different Ricky builds in this tournament, especially from Bobica. Obviously, the very memorable one outside of this tournament at DAC was the Triple Ring of Aquila. This yes. tournament, I've seen him go Yasha into Axe because he was the form. He has also gone Diffusal first in a game, I believe. So good variety. But this is the tested and true build that we're seeing coming up. Completely standard. And when you're in this kind of position, it definitely works. So, Death OTA, 9-second BKB. Do they want to
try? Yeah, like BKB, they have Skylark with the Aghanim Scepter as well. It does seem like their team fight
is
beginning to be overwhelmed.
He's actually going straight Mjolnir. He has Empower, so attack speed is great, and he also has Fire Rizzoling.
Sure.
When you have Fire Rizzoling and Empower, you hit pretty damn hard and fast, so it's nice.
Death's
cool to see a different
bounty.
Build. I'm still waiting for that moment where I'm like, oh, of course, this is why he went Mjolnir.
Yeah.
I still am not completely seeing it. Maybe I'm missing something very obvious here. It's like it doesn't specifically counter the wolves that well.
Yeah, they have strong magic.
Very high magic
right.
resistance. Obviously, you can put the.
Blessings.
You can put the static charge on the Juggernaut moving in. Who, by the way, now has a Scotty. Look at the graphs.
Getting pretty big.
I think this is the type of game where it's really good to look at the graphs because it tells a lot of a story when not so much is happening in terms of kills that. It's flatlining like this. For about five or six minutes, Mouse have not gained an advantage. And this is largely attributed to Magnus' power and, of course, Lina having this massive wave clear ability. And Mouse didn't seem to be able to break high ground here, so they're going to have to wait for the next Roche. And when you have a 5k lead, the longer the game goes, the less significant the 5k lead is. It just gets relatively smaller and smaller. And this Juggernaut is getting really, really big. So.
Yeah, it's keeping pace with the Templar Assassin pretty well,
yep.
considering that he really doesn't have a whole lot of map control to work off of. But as you see these items build up, he's now sitting at 2,500 HP. He's feeling a lot more comfortable pushing farther and farther. He even touched the river. It's been minutes. Tens
yep.
of minutes since he's done that.
It's been years since I've seen the
16-7, 31 minutes in. Cinderin is referring to Mousesports and their mid-game push lineup, very similar to game number one, is beginning to stall out. Now, they're still in a better situation than they were in 30 minutes last game, but you do have to worry that Mousesports are going to let IG wrest control away from them again. Waiting on Roshan number three, that'll be Aegis and Cheese.
It's up now.
So that'll be a better reward for them when they go high ground again.
This is the peak of their lineup, I think. This Aegis and Cheese with Abaddon Axe. Can't really stack more advantages unless you. It's a different story if they were just hardcore map controlling and kept gaining on the graph. Like, you keep out farming your opponent, you just build it up, get a 20k lead, and then go with like the fourth or the fifth Aegis.
Right.
But since that's not happening, I think this is the moment. You have Aegis and Cheese, you have Abaddon Axe. When the RP comes through, ideally Skylark wants to just save his ultimate now. He wants to save it all the way until. RP comes out, or Omni Slash gets used. Either of those two, he wants to ult so that he absorbs all of this damage from his carries in the fight. And and they even have the Aegis buffer now.
So how does IG defend? Do they threaten Skylark in order to try and force out an early ultimate, you know, before they use the big abilities, or do they strictly go for like the skewer play?
I think the skewer play, the skewer play is the best here. Blink, any blink skewer on a good hero will get them a good sign.
Not that easy.
TA with attraction and aphotic shield. Okay, there
we
go.
Oh, he's on XXS and he found an opening. He managed to jump thug, but the aphotic shield blinked back. Just you were referring to, Sin. Skylark drops a little bit low and a Laguna Blade on the thug. Almost loses his Aegis there. And Mouths are going to stall out.
There's so much lightning.
Oh my goodness.
Everywhere. There's lightning everywhere. Mjolnir on the Lina. Maelstrom on the Juggernaut, they actually deal so much AoE damage right now to this Mousesports lineup. And that's something that, yes, the Aquatic or the Abaddon Axe is really good at dealing with for a brief amount of time, but this sustained harassment, they don't have any sustained heal apart from Mist Coil.
Yeah.
I don't think there is. Do they have? They don't have an urn. Abaddon has the Vlads, but for that to have an effect, they need to go and heal in the jungle. And none of their heroes have a healing ability apart from Brain Zap or Bane himself. So they stop the push again very effectively. IG, they're buying time.
They've got the late game too, right? They've got strong late game potential. They also have, with these builds, really great ways to be able to deal with super creeps. They haven't seen that.
Oh, Ricky's
dead. Yeah, they're going to be able to catch MNT. Going to finish them off.
Was that just a backhand Laguna?
Yeah, it was. It was just like pimp hand, strong hand, you know?
Bitch flap, Ricky.
Yeah. Knock him around a little bit. Show him who's boss.
That looked pretty cool, actually. Is that a normal animation?
I feel like Lina always like switches her hand out and casts it outward. It was like he backhanded it.
I don't know, maybe I'm just seeing.
There's style points for IP. Huh. He's so good at the heroes.
I don't actually think he cares, he just wanted to kill him. So, why are we even talking about this guy? Can you stop bringing up irrelevant stuff?
Sorry, that's my fault. Go ahead and bring all that expert analysis into play.
It was backhanded.
16 and 8, 34 minutes in. Mouse still have that Aegis.
They're going
still
against.
Still have BKBs to work with. Let's see if, what is this, round number 3, 4?
Ricky's high ground pretty far away. They kind of have to wait for MNT to get there, and that should be, well, actually, this push top is insignificant.
Going in it once again, burning.
Oh, aggressive force staff once again with the beans. Griffin defensive force staff goes out. OP actually takes a bit of damage there, but does manage to get back to his well. Burning, drop low, but looks like they're going
to
try and focus with the BKB time.
He's on the building,
so they just have to back up. XXS is threatening them with the RP. And Mousesports, it's like their fourth or fifth attempt now going high ground, and it still does not accomplish it.
That is a big loss for Mouse, actually. They used both their BKBs and accomplished absolutely nothing with that play. They will, as a result, have to wait a minute for the BKBs to come online again. And guess what? Aegis is out in a minute and a half. So their moment of opportunity now is down to like 20 seconds if they want to go right away. And it looks like they're going to fall back to farming. And this is just game plan advancing for IG, very similar to the previous game. Want to find out as well, Shiva is coming up soon for the Lina here. Very, very good item choice in my opinion in this game. You want to have the armor against all of this physical damage. The attack speed slow is really annoying to deal with three of the Radiant heroes. And of course, the slow itself from casting the Shiva's guard sets up very nicely to land her own spells. This is bad news for Maus. They will try again. Before. Their BKBs are now online. Aegis. All right, they actually do have a full minute, so a bit more than expected.
Much like your pro playing career.
Okay, then.
You don't succeed, try again. But XXS, managed to get the skewer back. On to Thug, Laguna Blade cutting through. But they do manage to pop that BKB. He's at half health and OP's being threatened. He does manage to get his defensive force staff out from XXS, and he throws out that RP, stopping the Lycan from being able to finish off OP while burning down a half health, but have a healing ward up. Does manage to stay alive. Now the BKBs have worn out four mouths, and they're beginning to stall once again. They focus on Skylark, but OP in an awkward position actually gets caught out there. Spark manages to take him. Now burning against the three of them. Does manage to spin and stay alive through that bit of damage coming out from Thug, but mouths are finally looking at taking a melee Rex, but Lina's back up already. Now a skewer back, catches two, the bowling ball of XXS managed to just wreck through, almost taking down Skylark, but it's not enough, it gets off the ultimate, and now that damage has all been negated, and IG may not have the power to finish off Mousesports anymore. Belbica inside that shrine is going to be able to stay alive against maybe next time, a support down, Belbica does drop in exchange, but burning drops low, another shrine saves IG's positioning. Mouse continue to move forward though, they smell blood the water. They've waited for this opportunity, but the skewer back, and Mao's overextended themselves. Mater is gone, and the rest of Mao's have to retreat. Thels hoping to be able to slow down IG. It does look like that IG are not really going to look to pursue too much. They've lost a lane of racks, or one, actually, just the melee racks, not even the full lane. But that is recoverable for IG.
Crazy fight, but important for IG. The only buyback they blow is Bo, because all of their cores lost very little. OP did die, but had the Bloodstone and came back to life. Burning stays alive. He will have a full AC going into the next fight. And as far as Mouse goes, they kept their cheese. I got really excited there because Skylark had literally half a second cooldown on the borrowed time when he was about to die, and then it came online. He had the cheese the whole time. He's like absolutely ice cold under pressure in that fight, waits for the ulti to come online, and as a result, the cheese is now saved, so they will have that extra advantage going into the next fight, which will more than likely be with the fourth Roshan of the game, because now they can't go high ground once again. So, something we have to keep in mind now, Mao's BKBs are dropping in duration. It's very, very important. Templar Assassin is down to 7, Lycan is down to 8. Just a couple of more fights, these low-duration BKBs will become a problem, not because RP and Overgrowth aren't already good against them, but when they run out, this Lina is twice as strong. When they're out of BKB, all of her spells can land, Shiva's can land, Mjolnir can bounce. There's going to be too much damage. I think Mousesports will lose any fight when their BKBs are down, unless they've built a significant enough advantage up during the fight by forcing out key cooldowns.
And we have some really big peaks being landed here pretty soon for Mousesports. The Templar Assassin, 9 refraction charges. Like, that's a really big one for
that's
her,
big.
Right? That really extends some of her late game potential. The Abaddon, another big one. Level 22, gets to level 25. He has that huge increase in the Aphonic Shield.
That is like crazy good.
Yeah, those are really like the maxed out Mousesports, right? So IG, they could even lose this second lane of Brax and still push this lane, still manage to survive because Mousesports, they still fall out.
Oh, they're splitting up nicely. They'll moderate in the bottom lane. It's just a distraction. IG have not even noticed yet.
Yeah, they're starting to move, but the tier 3 is already gone. The melee axe is going to go down soon. A BKB activated by Thug. He says, if you go for Madara, I'll take you. He managed to pick up one already. XXS is gone with no RP and no buyback. Burning is already down. He's trying to finish up the rest of these members of Mouse. They say bottom is gone. We have to kill the Mouse members, and Skylark is going to fall as well. So they took 2 cores out of that. Big plays from Mousesports. A second lane of Brax gone.
Great approach to this moment. They basically found the perfect moment of opportunity where IG were caught off guard. IG have no vision whatsoever outside of their base, so they didn't even notice Madara sneaking in from the outside. Actually, they do have one ward down at their shrine, but he was playing around the woods area above it, so they didn't see the movement. And this is one of Lycan's big strengths as a hero. It goes so quickly. And IG's lineup, this is a weakness that we actually haven't touched upon very much. They're so good at team fighting, but once this gets split up, it gets really difficult for them. However, Mouse can't do this next time because now there's only one lane left.
Exactly, right?
But really, really, really great play coming out from them. High ground time for IG, however.
Gee, they are trying to force some buybacks from Mouse. We know there's not buyback on either one of these. IG will eventually realize it too. The match on the burning onto that tier 3 tower. Very minimum, they're hoping to be able to unlock Shrine Tier, but a Glyph use and Madara threatening with the ultimate. IG still have to be careful. Still scared a little bit of those buyback. Now jump forward. Madara actually dropping low. Force that forward. Entangle as well, but Madara pops the BKB and the damage isn't enough. He managed to get himself away, and now Mousesports, their 2 cores will come back naturally, and they leave their Tier 3 tower at half HP.
Great hold. If you only pay a BKB to hold this, that is pretty much all you could have hoped for. It looked scary for a moment there for Madara, but knowing the limits of its heroes, its hero very well, 3,000 health, bottom armor. I think he got caught off guard, actually, by a multicast from the Ogre, and that allowed for the Lina to set up her stun, but there was no follow-through RP or overgrowth after that BKB. Both spells were on cooldown at the time. Actually, Bobica did get it up, but it was too late.
IG, they were praying. They backed up, they immediately went into the Roshan pit, hoping that Roshan was going to be up. It was not. It's going to be a late Roshan. Well timed for Mousesports to retake control of the map and take that fourth that second cheese. But RP goes out. They managed to smoke up, wrap around, managed to find Madara. Will bring him down pretty easily.
He actually just bought an item. He doesn't have buyback. This could be a very, very costly mistake for Mouse. The Roche is spawning in 20 seconds. This is a tier 2 top and a Roche for IG if they just make the right moves. But at the same time, maybe next time it's pushing out mid.
And if he goes and threatens them top, perhaps they can split. Ah, he can't do that.
They've got two members following up. Thug is following through with this. They realize without this buyback, they can't contest top. The only way they can force IG back is threatening to go through mid into top lane. And that's exactly what happens. IG actually backs
Jugger.
Up.
Jugger had a Manta in the Roche pit, and 4 seconds after it expires, Roche spawns. So they don't even know that Roshan is up. And Mals have the advantage in terms of just raw knowledge here. If they get this Roche in a 4-on-5 scenario, that is absolutely huge for them. And it looks like it is going to happen. Just the threat of TA going up through mid because Ricky was there to push in the first place scares IG enough that they have to go back to base. And Mals will claim it here. Aegis and Cheese going their way. Cheese is currently on maybe next time, and the Aegis sitting on the Templar Assassin of Thug. Big plays. Mals are showing really, really great plays in this game. I have to commend them for that.
Yes.
They've made so many good decisions in a row.
We weren't sure about the draft so much and if it was really going to make the difference, but it seemed like Mals have made the adjustments to make this mid-game push really
I was a hater,
them.
I guess.
You were a hater.
I was a hater. I didn't believe in it.
It's Mousesports said,
really
see you later,
right
Sin.
For them.
They are just one push away.
Okay. Look at the graphs.
Yep.
In spite of this, there are two lanes of racks up. There are two lanes of racks up. They've taken 4 Roshans. They're 6 kills up. It's still even. It's pretty incredible when you look at it.
And this push is going to be
refresher on
so
mech
hard.
Is on cooldown. That's a big deal. Yeah. I don't know if Mouse noticed that it was on cooldown for XXS.
He used it like immediately after they killed Madara, so I would assume they do. This would be a great time to push. One arc.
Yep.
That being said, I don't see any way that this one push actually results in the lane of access. We do have some buybacks.
Yeah.
Burning has one. That's a very good one.
Good stun.
King's off, trying to get some damage out. Fiend's grip onto Burning to move him forward and deeper into the trees. Double force down. They actually get him all the way on top of the cliff. Maybe that's not so good. What could Burning do here? He can't actually get away. They're wiping through the rest of the rest of the IG members, and they're focusing on the tier 3 tower while Spartan just controls Burning. You're my puppet now, he says. He keeps him onto that cliff while Skylark and the rest can focus on these buildings. They're just trying to stop his TP out, who finally managed to get down. The tier 3 is already gone, though, and some of the IG members are gone. OP just comes back up from his death. Timer on slash goes down, but Mouse fully focused on the buildings at this point. It is an objective game. They've taken on the melee racks, soon to be focusing on the range racks. Irrecoverable damage that Thug is going to be able to get out. Takes that range racks. It is gone. Mega creeps have been achieved from Mousesports. They just need to try and get as many members out as possible. RP laid down by XXS. They really want to be able to take Moderate here. They need to be able to get these kills and somehow force buybacks. But if Moderate runs himself away, or maybe he fights, he turns, he fights, he looks for Bulbica, is able to take him down. OP's threatened, has to go back to the fountain. That leaves XXS with a three-man RP, but can Burning possibly output the damage to be able to finish him off? It just doesn't seem possible. Burning is melting. He goes down, and IG, they lose game 2. Mousesports are in their feet in the booth.
Sick game from them. Really, really good stuff. And all of it, again, it just comes down to Mouse see these very small windows of opportunity. Again, this time it's on Burning. They put this amount of pressure with the, I think it was the Fiend script again this time around on Burning that forced the four staffs out. Arguably unfortunate that he gets forced off on the cliff there. I think that might be a defense if they don't do it. But at the same time, can't really blame IG